Just before we start, I'd like to give a shout out to Squarespace for sponsoring today's video. If you remember a short while back, we did a video on the world's most powerful magnets. Well, I thought we'd revisit that rabbit hole which had opened up, and this time look at the world's most powerful electric motors which have benefited from the increased power of these new magnets. Something else I found out after making the magnet video was that the Sony Walkman was helped significantly by the use of samarium cobalt magnets in the lightweight headphones, which gave them a much better bass response than would have been expected from what was a very small magnet, and in turn greatly increased their popularity. I also touched on new powerful small motors in things like consumer drones and hand tools. So this time I thought we'd look at the other end of the scale, at motors which are used in cars and other much bigger forms of transport and one-off projects. We are living at a time when things are developing at an increasing rate, and transport is now firmly at the forefront of this as we try to move away from fossil fuels to electricity. But electric transport was one of the original forms predating petrol and diesel by over 50 years. The first true electric locomotive was built by the Scottish chemist Robert Davidson in 1842. The 7-ton locomotive, called Galvani, used two direct drive magnetic reluctance motors powered by 20 galvanic single-use cells and could haul 6.5 tonnes at 6.5 kilometres per hour for 2.4 kilometres. The major problem here was that it was before rechargeable batteries had been invented, and the cells required to power the loco were more expensive than the coal for steam locomotives, and it burned through them at an almost equally fast rate, making it a technological and economic dead end at the time. But the magnetic reluctance motor was a different and more interesting story. This type of motor differed from a traditional electric motor, with windings on the rotor and magnets around the outside, by having the reverse, windings around the outside, and a rotor with soft iron cores that acted as a temporary magnet, and relying upon magnetic reluctance to induce a magnetic field into the rotor. By turning on and off alternating coils and creating a rotating magnetic field, the rotor becomes a multipole temporary magnet, the poles of which are attracted and repelled by the magnetic fields created by the coils. However, because in the early days the control of the coils was primitive, reluctance motors suffered from vibration and noise due to torque ripple at low speed. That's the difference between the maximum and minimum torque during one revolution, so their use was really rather limited. But they were more efficient than induction motors, which lose more energy through heat as the rotors heat up. It's only with the introduction of computer-based microcontrollers in the last 20 years or so that could monitor the speed and the position of a rotor and adjust the rotating magnetic field accordingly so that they never go out of synchronisation. This synchronised control can also react to sudden increases in load, and due to their increased torque, which is up to 15% more than an induction motor, reluctance motors are now taking over from inductance motors as a new, more powerful solution for the 21st century, and one place where they are increasingly being used is in electric cars. With the release of the Model 3, Tesla has been moving from induction motors to SRMs, or synchronous reluctance motors, and we are seeing some amazing performance figures from cars like the Tesla Plaid, offering supercar performance from a four-seat saloon at a fraction of the price using these new, more powerful motors. Now, while Tesla have been resurrecting ancient motor technology, Koenigsegg has gone back to one of the first motor designs, with their new quark motor, which is an axial flux motor, also known as a pancake motor. Axial flux motors are a very old motor design, but it's only been in recent times with the availability of these new high-power permanent magnets that it's been able to be used for high-power applications. These motors have the rotor and the stator parallel to each other, rather than being a cylindrical style with one being inside the other. This type of low-profile motor is commonly used in devices like hard drives and computer cooling fans, with the coils mounted directly onto a printed circuit board and the magnets fixed to the rotor. So Koenigsegg has used lots of exotic materials to keep the weight down and the strength up. Because the torque generated is created by the magnetic field acting on the magnets, the way the magnets are fixed to the rotor is key. They must be strong enough so that they don't get ripped off by the shearing force of the torque, and they don't fly off at high speed due to centripetal force. So the rotor is made from hollow carbon fibre, the same technology they developed for making super light yet strong road wheels. The upshot of this is they have created a motor that is not only very small and weighs just 28 kilos, but can generate up to 335 horsepower and 443 pound-feet of torque, but for only about 20 seconds, after which it drops to 134 horsepower and 184 pound-feet of torque, presumably to prevent it from overheating. As Koenigsegg have stated, this flat pancake-style motor will suit other forms of transport too, such as electric aircraft, boats, and vertical takeoff and landing. The motor is not only very powerful, but because it can rev to high RPMs, there's no need for a gearbox, thus reducing the weight even more and taking up less space. Koenigsegg say that they are looking at supplying it to other industry sectors and have even made a combined dual motor and inverter drive unit for electric vehicles called the Terrier. This can deliver up to 670 horsepower and 811 pounds-feet of torque and weighs in at 84 kilos and could be bolted directly into the subframe or chassis of another vehicle. However, when it comes to real high-power motors, ship engines are the biggest and are on a scale that make normal combustion or electric motors look tiny by comparison. The biggest reciprocating internal combustion ship engine is the 14-cylinder Wärtsilä RT Flex 96C, which is a two-stroke diesel capable of producing 107,390 horsepower and 5,608,310 pound-feet of torque. This monster weighs in at over 2,300 tons and is 26.6 meters long and 13.5 meters high. Each of the 14 pistons weighs 5.5 tons and displaces 1,828 liters and contributes 7,780 horsepower to the output, and the crankshaft alone weighs 300 tons. To keep this running, it uses 250 tons of diesel per day and hums along at a leisurely 102 rpm. So you would think that there aren't any electric motors that can get near this, but you would be wrong. The Royal Navy's HMS Queen Elizabeth class carriers are the second largest in the world after the Nimitz class and are the first fully electrically powered carriers built. They are powered by four General Electric 20 megawatt advanced induction motors, which is equivalent to 27,000 horsepower each. Two of these motors drive each of the two propeller shafts, giving a total power output of 108,000 horsepower. Each of the tandem motors weighs 110 tons, and because they are much smaller than one large ship engine like the Wärtsilä, they can fit into smaller independent compartments, freeing up space for other uses and distributing the propulsion power, so that if one were to be incapacitated, the ship can still maneuver. One of the reasons why they went for a fully electric design was that it would be cheaper than a nuclear steam generation, and the fuel savings compared to a traditional diesel like the Wärtsilä. It's reckoned that the 65,000-ton carrier will use about the same as a 22,000-ton vessel over its lifetime. As more electric ships come online, new, more powerful electric motors are being developed, and one of the most powerful so far has been developed by Northrop Grumman for the US Navy. This uses high-temperature superconducting coils that make it not only more powerful but much smaller. The HTS motor is a 36.5 megawatt, equivalent to 49,000 horsepower, and yet it weighs about 75 tons. And the amount of torque it generates is 2.13 million pound feet. So comparing this to the Wärtsilä, two of these coming in at 150 tons and less than the size of two of its pistons would provide 91% of the horsepower and 76% of the torque. Of course, creating over 70 megawatts of electrical power to drive the motors is another matter, which could have been easily solved by going nuclear, but that was not an option the Royal Navy wanted to take. On the HMS Queen Elizabeth and the US Zumwalt class destroyers, this is generated by two Rolls-Royce MT30 gas turbine generators based on the Rolls-Royce Trent 800 aero engine, the engine for the Boeing 777. These can supply 70 megawatts of power and is backed up by four smaller Wartzilla diesel electric generators providing another 40 megawatts to give a total of 110 megawatts. But it's not only ships that need very large electric motors. In 1997, NASA upgraded one of the largest electric motors in the world to the largest electric motor in the world. Though it has been around now for 25 years, so there may be something bigger that could be around now. But at the time, it was the largest horizontal single motor drive combination. The motor here is used in NASA's National Transonic Facility to power its transonic wind tunnel and is the world's largest adjustable speed drive system that powers a fan to produce wind speeds of up to Mach 1.2 that's been used to test the Boeing 777, 767 space shuttle. Although many of these were actually tested at a time when it had the old 60 megawatt motor fitted but could only run at full power for 10 minutes at a time, hence the upgrade in 1997. The wind tunnel is a closed-loop high-pressure system with a test area measuring 2.5 metres high by 2.5 metres wide. It uses nitrogen gas to cool the air to replicate the flight dynamics on small-scale models, and unlike a full-scale wind tunnel, it can adjust the airflow to match any model size down to 1/50th scale. It uses an AC synchronous motor rated at 101 megawatts or 135,000 horsepower with a variable speed from 300 to 600 RPM. The motor itself measures 5.4 meters long by 6 meters wide by 7 meters high, excluding coolers and other accessories, weighs 360 tons and is considerably larger than the test area itself. The motor, custom four-winding transformer, harmonic filter and associated control system was built by ABB in Switzerland before being shipped to the US and installed in NASA's facility at Hampton, Virginia. So apart from some hydroelectric plants which use their generators in reverse to pump water back uphill, so technically they aren't dedicated motors, that's about as big as they get at the moment. Unless, of course, you know of something that I've missed out on. This video is sponsored by Squarespace. Now, I've been around the internet long enough to remember hand-coding websites with HTML back in the early 90s. But if you want to get started with a website for your business, blog or portfolio, you don't have to worry about anything like that now. With Squarespace, you can have a beautiful-looking website to grow your business or online presence. You can connect with your audience and generate revenue through gated members-only content. Manage your members, send email communications, and connect with your social media accounts to push your website content to them and spread the word via your followers, all in one easy-to-use platform. You can create a community with your website and use their powerful included blogging tools to categorize, schedule, and share posts, and build interaction with their fully integrated commenting system. If you're managing an online store, then they have new third-party tools to manage inventory, promote products, track your sales, and handle tax and shipping around the world. All you need to do to get started is to go to squarespace.com for a free trial. Then, when you're ready to launch, go to squarespace.com/curiousdroid to save 10% off your first purchase of a website or domain.